We're good? All right, so 7:04, little technology delay. I'll call the regularly scheduled select board meeting for Tuesday, May 10th to order. And our first item of business is approval of minutes of the April 26, 2016 regular select board meeting and the May 3rd, 2016 facilities tour.
Oh, both together?
We'll take one at a time. I'd like to take the regular select board meeting minutes first.
I'll make a motion for that.
Second.
So we have a motion and a second. Are there any recommended changes, additions to the select board meeting minutes?
Nope.
Heather? Nothing? There was one thing, we bounced back and forth on percentage. There was one thing I noticed. Let me see if I can find it. The percentage of completion, we were approving of the Polk Mill Bridge sidewalk project.
Yeah.
I just wanted to verify we had the percentage correct in there. I had a motion by Susan Sashok moved to approve 25% of the conceptual plans. Was it the 25%? Was it 25, 30? I just wanted to verify, was that the right
plan
percentage?
Plan said 25, and he kept saying 30.
That's right. Yeah.
And so the 25 was what we went 20, with.
25. Okay.
All right.
Because that's what the plan said, right. But he, the I can't. I'm sorry. I'm drawing. Adam kept saying 30.
Yeah,
he did, but he even agreed that 25% because
okay.
That's what
right.
The plan said.
What the plan said.
So
yep.
Then I don't have any recommended changes. Anybody else? So with no recommended changes or amendments to the draft minutes, all in favor of the select board meeting minutes as drafted, signify by saying aye.
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 Aye. Those opposed? So now let's turn to the facilities tour notes. There was a quorum on the facilities tour.
I move that we accept the notes.
Okay. Laura moved. Donald, you
second.
Care to second those? Yes, thank you. Are there any additions anybody would like to make to the facilities tour notes? Hearing none, those of us that were in attendance signified by approval, signified by saying aye.
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 And I abstain.
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 You have three abstentions, or two abstentions?
Three.
Three.
Three abstentions,
like
yeah.
There.
Okay. So, next on the agenda is citizen comments, and that is up, sorry. Next on the agenda is approval of the agenda.
I'll make a motion to approve the agenda as written.
We actually have a addition, Nick, that I'd like to add, and that's we had late today. There was an addition to the packet for everybody. We received the RL Valley second class liquor license and tobacco application, and I'd like to deal with that. If we could deal with that, my proposal would be we would deal with that right after the citizen comments.
Okay.
If everybody's okay with that, mm-hmm. That would be the only amendment I have. So then. Approval of the agenda.
As amended.
Seconded.
Yep.
So we have a motion to approve by Nick and second by Laura. Any other additions? No?
Mm-hmm.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed? Okay. So now we'll go to citizen comments, and it's an opportunity for anybody who is in attendance to speak to anything that is not on the warrant agenda or amended agenda. So hearing none, we'll move to the liquor license application from RL Valley. So.
Hi there. I am Otto Hansen with RL Valley.
We're here tonight applying for a second class liquor license and tobacco license for a store that we're in the process of acquiring, currently known as Middlebury Beef in East Middlebury.
And is Ann here?
Ann is not here, but the liquor license is in your packet and it is complete. Prepare for your approval.
Okay.
And it looks like police and fire chief have inspected.
I was just looking.
No comments on that, negative.
So it looks like they the police and fire chief both approved, recommended approval.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
So. Any questions?
I'll make a motion that we approve the second class liquor license and tobacco application for RL Valley Incorporated doing business as Maple Fields.
Second.
It's not Maple Fields, so is it?
It will be.
Oh, it will be in Maple Fields.
Currently Middlebury Beef, where when we take over, it'll be Maple Fields.
Okay.
Okay. Any other questions? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed? Okay.
Great.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
So I would invite Doug Sinclair to the chair.
Good evening. I'm Doug Sinclair. I'm Executive Director of Charterhouse Coalition. And we are here to request a certificate of local government approval to expand the warming shelter that we've operated the last three winters to include a day station so that the folks who were serving at night have a place to be during the day where they can do constructive things and don't have to be out and about trying to find shelter of one kind or another. It will also allow us to interact a lot more with them to get them the help that they need to take positive steps forward. We try to do that at the warming shelter, but they arrive at 7 in the evening and they're hungry, and we feed them and we have some good conversation, and then they get their bedding together, and pretty soon it's 9:15 and they want to go to bed because it's pretty tiring to be outside all day long. So we make some progress, but we know we can do much better, and it provides a much better opportunity for all the partner organizations that we work with: Parent Child Center, Women's Safe, Hope, John Graham, CSAC, Pathways. They can now meet with our folks at hours when they work, between 8 and 5, and we can provide space for them to do that. So from our perspective, it's better for our guests, it's better for us because we can help them better, and I think it's better for the community because they have a constructive place to be during the day.
Mm-hmm. So Doug, why now, like as opposed to like last year?
You know, when we first started the warming shelter, we tried for several years to get the state to help us to fund it because we have to have overnight paid awake staff, and we're a volunteer-based organization. It's just not possible to get volunteers to do that, stay awake all night, night after night after night. They agreed with that finally, and we started that up, and after a year in, we said, you know what, the next step is a day station. Mm-hmm. And they surprised us about 3 weeks ago, and the money that's come out this year includes the possibility of a day station, so we're not hesitating to mm-hmm. jump on it now. Again, volunteers do most of our work, but with something like a day station, you've got to have solid continuity from day to day to day, and so we need to have some paid staff to do that as well, and so we need the state funding primarily to cover the paid staff.
What kind of numbers are you do are looking at serving, out of curiosity?
Well, the maximum will be 15 in a day.
Okay.
Over last winter, the shelter that served individuals, we served a total of 42 people over the course of the winter. On a given night, in the cold part of the winter, we were at capacity, which nominally was 12, but we found a way to handle 14 because the need was there. And so we're thinking 15 is the right number. A little bigger than the number of people who would stay at the shelter, because people come in during the day now and they logically go to Charterhouse, where you can get free meals, and they know there's a shelter there, but oftentimes there's no staff there at certain times of the day, and so by having the day station there, we can start to serve their needs immediately and not have them wondering if they're going to have a place to stay all day. And if we're at capacity, then we can help them to find somewhere else to stay that night rather than have them show up at 7 o'clock and then we're scrambling to try and find someplace for them.
But my question is actually if you have 42 and then 15 is your capacity for a day, it's a real cold day, where do the other 27 go?
Oh, it varies from time to time. Okay, we never have more than 14 people in the individual shelter. We also have a shelter upstairs for families, but they can stay there 24/7.
Okay.
And so they don't really need this service. But on any given night, we can't handle more than 14.
Okay, okay.
So.
Okay.
Any other questions? There's no other questions of Doug. What's the pleasure of the board?
I'll move that we order to authorize you, our board chair, to sign the certificate of local government approval, approving the proposal from the Charterhouse Coalition to expand the warming shelter in the fall to include a day.
Second.
Station.
Okay. We have a motion and a second to approve and to authorize me to sign the certification of local government approval. Are there any other comments? Not. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
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 Those opposed?
Thank you very much.
You. Very nice service.
Thank you.
Come forward and talk to us about the Lake Park.
Thank you. I'm Carl Robinson, the Executive Director for the Middlebury Area Land Trust. I am here tonight to talk to you about a program from the Audubon Society. We were contacted by the Audubon Society, Mark Labar, a few months ago about doing some survey work for bird habitat. As part of this, he wanted to continue and do some work in some areas around Middlebury, including Wright Park and some other areas in Weybridge. He is asking that, or he is wanting to do some habitat work in Wright Park, so he is asking the select board for approval to do this work. He's seeking funds through the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, and he'll be able to do some habitat work for some, actually it's the Champlain Valley Bird Initiative, and I don't know a whole lot about the initiative. The Audubon group in town, the local group, is doing more work with that, and I believe there's a representative here tonight. I don't know if you want to speak on the part of that. Okay, sorry. This is Ron Payne. He's part of the Audubon Society locally. But we are seeking permission from the select board to do this work. He would seek funds, and then we would do some habitat work in Wright Park. So we're asking the town's permission.
Mm-hmm. So we need a landowner agreement, mm-hmm. And Carl was suggesting that the funds would be through the town of Middlebury. Any grant
money
would come to us, and it would be expended probably on a reimbursement basis.
Mm-hmm. Correct. Thank you.
Can you give a little more specifics on exactly what the habitat work means? Are you clearing trees, planting trees?
It would be clearing some area. So there are some fields that are being encroached upon. So it'd be enhancing this habitat. Habitat that I did a little looking up is for instance, the golden-winged warbler or eastern towhee habitat, kind of the between grassland and forest area. So it'd be enhancing this area. So a little bit of clearing of invasive species, making better habitat. Mm-hmm. So yes, a little bit of clearing.
So do you have any kind of sketch plan for what we're talking about acreage-wise and what we're looking... I mean, I understand we're trying to maintain habitat. I understand. Mm-hmm. But I just was looking for a little bit more detail.
Sure. I do not have that yet from Mark. Okay. He is working on this whole proposal. As far as acreage, I am not sure.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I'm not necessarily opposed to the idea. I just wanted a little bit more detail about what we were actually talking about. Mm-hmm. And I just, so that people from the public have questions, work goes on there, and they say, why are you doing that, and what is the final product going to look like, we would have some answers.
Sure.
For that.
I can definitely look up that information through the Vermont Audubon Society. They have the Champlain Valley Bird Initiative, and they have a lot of detailed information about what they have done and actually sample areas that they've worked on. So through that, I could find some more information for you. And
so
for the public, we could
so
direct that to the public.
So they've done this in other areas, then?
Yes, they
yeah.
have.
So maybe somebody has some pictures, even, of before and after?
I believe so, yes.
That would be great.
Mm-hmm. So the town would just be holding the funds as a service to Audubon to do this work? It's not requiring the town to commit any funds?
Correct.
Okay.
Okay, that actually helps clarify something, because there was a budget in the proposal, and that was my first question, is this part of our budget? And so we're effectively authorizing the Audubon Society to come onto town-owned property in, under their budget, to fulfill a plan that's coordinated through Fish and Wildlife in the Audubon Society. And
yes, so the Audubon Society has a proposal they give to U.S. Fish and Wildlife. They have a partnership program.
Yeah.
Again, they have some sample areas that they've done this. I believe in Hinesburg is one area. So funds went to the town, and it was a pass-through to contractors who did some of the invasive removal and kind of the consulting work from Audubon. So
yeah, that's mm-hmm. kind of what I understood. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So are there any other questions? So
Wright Park is beautiful and blooming, and the birds should enjoy it as much as us.
I think it is a good idea to have some sort of sense of what it would look like, too. Mm-hmm. So I would appreciate that. It'd be nice.
Well, it does say heavy mechanicized, you know, brontosaurus timber harvest. This, you know, is serious equipment, and I just think we should have a clear picture of what it's going to mean when people start asking questions on what's going on in Wright Park and why we're changing it and... Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And
not that I'm opposed to it. I just think it would be a good idea to have details about it so that we can say this is the before, this is the after, this is what we're envisioning type.
And actually, the brontosaurus was not part of the initial work plan as I read it. It was mostly rotary cutting and
right, it does say
trying to get shrub
announced.
Type growth coming back. But mm-hmm. but I understand. So is the pleasure of the board to see something more before you make a recommendation, or where does the board sit on this?
Well, one of the things we're looking at is conditional approval. So could that be part of the condition that we are presented with?
Condition of the submission of
an example.
Because we're actually approved by council, but then that can also be a matter of us getting a visual. So. Just an example.
So provide an example and more detailed as far as acreage and what areas we would work on in Wright Park. Mm-hmm. Could definitely work on that with the Audubon Society.
Mm-hmm. Well, I do wonder too, just for going through and knowing about it, you know, what sort of committee should be or subcommittee should be overseeing that. It's not necessarily something we're approving, but I don't know if Parks and Rec wants to take a look at those pictures and be able to track it. You know, who, which would, one of our committees would...
Well, it's Park, and so right. The county goes through Parks and Rec, and MALT sits as part of the right. Parks and Rec boards
so,
and our committee, so...
Maybe they're the ones who would also benefit to see that and to be able to track it as the project goes through.
With Parks and Rec?
Yeah, why not?
Sure. And I believe the Middlebury Area Land Trust is the kind of acting manager of Wright Park, so we would be responsible of, you know, letting the public know what's mm-hmm. going on, as well as informing the select board. You know, the plans for big projects like this. But any work that would be done, we would have a supervisor from the Middlebury Area Land Trust out there to make sure it's doing the proper work. It's not damaging mm-hmm. the trail, damaging other areas when heavy equipment is going in. So we would work in close coordination with any work being done.
So can we provide conditional approval subject to acceptable plans and answering of the questions that you provided, mm-hmm. Carl, this evening?
That would be appropriate. And as you say, MALT has traditionally had a supervisory role with regard to Wright Park. It's not as though you're coming into something new and we're unfamiliar with what you do and how you do it. So I think conditional condition would be to submit a more detailed plan that we would then give final approval to. Mm-hmm.
So I'll seek a motion then. And
I'd move that if a...
Okay. We have a motion from Vicar. Second, anyone?
Do you want me to say the other things in there too, or?
Sure.
To provide conditional approval for the landowner agreement once finalized and reviewed by council, and with the understanding that the town will only act as a pass-through agent for U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service funding and will not incur any direct expense in relation to the project, in addition to what?
You're adding that to the
if
motion.
If that's okay.
I'll accept that.
Okay.
Amending the motion.
Because yours was good.
Okay.
I'll second it. Or has it been?
Well, that was a second, and she verified with
okay.
the gentleman who made the motion.
Yes, okay.
Directly to your right that he was okay with
this
her
yes.
addition. So, all in favor of the motion, signify by saying aye.
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 Aye. Those opposed?
Thank you.
Carl.
Good evening.
Donna, personnel
yes.
committee report.
Yes, our personnel committee met just recently. We discussed two specific jobs. One was public works operations director, and the other is assistant zoning. I should open that and look at it so I have the titles right.
Yeah.
Anyway, during the course of the discussion, I think in the packet, I know we've seen this before, we had discussed the position of the public works director. Essentially, the description that you have that we had looked at previously to this time is the same description. Also in the packet, though, is a timeline for looking for the position, to advertise it, to interview, to vet the person, and then to hopefully have them on the job actually by the last day in August. I don't know if anyone had any questions on the reporting of the position or on the description of the job.
I do.
Looking,
So the description for the operations director is what we looked at before?
Mm-hmm. Yes,
okay.
It is.
Well, it was clear to me, except that I just wasn't sure about Parks and Rec, you know, because there wasn't a specific
right.
reference to them, so I just wanted clarification about that.
That is one thing that the committee asked for, was to include that in the job description specifically. That was an oversight
okay.
on my part.
Okay.
I'm
yes.
sorry. I missed part of that, Laura. What it was the...
Laura asked about Parks and Rec.
Oh, Parks and Rec. Okay, I'm sorry.
...of that in the job description.
Okay.
That said, we are currently thinking about that. Is that the best place for it within our organization, given mm-hmm. our recreation department's focus, our Parks and Recreation department's focus on recreation?
I'm sorry.
So you're still discussing the words
that she said.
Right now, as proposed, it's included.
It is included in the job description.
It should be included in the job description. It's not.
It's left out of the first paragraph.
It will be
added. Okay. So, if you look at the knowledge, skills, abilities required, and who is going to cover it, it will be added to that to the paragraph above that it supports the highway department, the water department, equipment, and supports wastewater treatment. It will be also included in there. Will be Parks and Recreation.
Okay, and you do want that there,
we
as opposed
to
discussing it further to be sure, or if that is where you want it included.
Yes, we do want it there.
Okay,
right. And if you look at the org mm-hmm. chart that we have, it's listed in the org chart as reporting up through operations director as well.
Yep. I know, that's what we saw at town meeting.
Right.
Okay.
And so going forward, I mean, I think that that's the way we'd like to approve the description itself as well.
Right, so you'd want consistency, unless you're going to talk about a different
org chart, I think, is as we intended it to be.
Okay, just being clear.
Yeah. Okay. Everyone else see that, or?
Mm-hmm.
You have a question, Nick?
I do, Donna. Under knowledge, skills, abilities required, you mentioned that you talk about it on a second page, but since facilities management is different in some respects than public works, to also maybe put another bullet point of knowledge, I would say knowledge of institutional facilities management and experience.
Where are you, Nick?
On page one.
On page one?
Under knowledge, skills, and abilities required, to emphasize that also is an important trait we'll be looking for.
Are you looking at bullet one? What bullet number are you on, Nick?
I am on the knowledge, skills, and abilities required.
Yep.
Okay.
Yep.
And put it just as an additional bullet.
Okay, I see.
I'm sorry, an additional bullet that just mentions facilities in addition to public works.
So
yes,
just as
can.
A follow-up to mm-hmm. that particular point, the mm-hmm. committee was somewhat concerned that we are asking for this person to do a lot of things, and we're going to have to closely watch that this is a doable job.
Right, yeah.
Well, and that actually was another thought I had, is between this and the other position, how rigid are these respective jobs? And I'm thinking, for example, we may have a situation where the best candidate we get has 90% of these skills, but they're lacking one of those. But is that something that could be transferred to the other position, so that we ultimately get the complete package, whoever does it, and not just now, but in the future, as personnel change?
Mm-hmm. So. I think that's a good point.
Yeah, and I do think, we do say it in the opening overview that it's responsible for facilities maintenance and management, which would, I hope, imply that they should have some kind of facility background. But to your point, it's going to be a learning curve in that first year. There are a lot of responsibilities in the position, and if the candidate has the vast majority of them, he can certainly learn probably some of the others. And so I think, it may evolve somewhat as the person takes that position.
Well, it does, professionally, I experienced it with the national parks. I mean, the chief of maintenance does. This is a chief of maintenance description, and it's they're often skills that are learned, and sometimes shifted, so that ultimately you just get the complete package.
Mm-hmm. So, would you prefer the bullet be actually added into the description?
I think that would be best, and it is just to put another bullet of knowledge of, I would say, institutional facilities management, which is a rather broad term as I would define it, but it could be any multiple building type of facilities management.
Well, then I'd like to recommend that we accept the position in the timeline. We'll accept the position with the additional description of knowledge of institutional facility management.
Thank you.
If everyone's comfortable with that.
Yeah.
So I have a motion from Donna to approve the personnel committee's recommendation. The proposed job description and recruitment timeline for the new public works director position.
Yes.
Second.
Seconded by Victor. Any other comments on that? Hearing none, all in favor of the motion as stated, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? Okay. Donna, I think you have another.
I do. I have a second one. Jennifer Murray prepared a wonderful description of the position for assistant
zoning and planning
director. And in that, in the description, she opened up and explained to the personnel committee really, really well what the responsibilities of that are and the kind of person that you would hope would seek the position. And we talked about people who are at entry-level positions. We talked about people who are at retirement age. She's very hopeful and optimistic that we'll get somebody who's more of an entry-level, someone that we could keep here for a while, since turnover is an issue sometimes in positions like that. I think the job description itself is very, very clear that she gave us. And I think, again, if you looked at her description in that packet of what she's looking for, I think that also was very self-explanatory. So I would recommend that we accept Jennifer's job description for Assistant Zoning Administrator, DRB Coordinator, as it was presented to us, and that we, upon approval of it, start advertising that position.
Second.
Mm-hmm. Motion from Donna, seconded by Victor again. Any other comments on that position?
No, it looks good.
I will say that the personnel committee was impressed with her preparedness.
Yes.
Did a very good job.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Those opposed? Okay.
I have to make all those notes. I couldn't find them.
Thank you, Donna.
Can I ask a quick question?
Absolutely.
On the subject? On the organization chart, we have the planning director separated. Have you guys already discussed the job description for that, or is that something that's coming?
That's something that's coming.
Okay. Thank you.
Jim, I'll invite you forward.
Thank you.
For an update on our local project management team's activities.
Yeah. Hello, everyone. Good evening. I'd like to bring you briefly up to date tonight on a number of issues and concerns in front of the local project management team, including the LPMT's reaction to the second letter from Peter Langrock. And so I'll briefly run over some of those issues and concerns. A year from now, at this time, if all goes according to plan, the Merchants Row Bridge will be in the process of being taken down and rebuilt, as will the rail line be rebuilt too at that time. So I want to start by talking about a couple things that are taking place this fall. I've mentioned before there's two primary activities that will take place in the fall, and that will be the construction of a water street access road that will run into the Battelle block to facilitate the flow of construction vehicles and the use of the Battelle block while the Merchants Row Bridge is down, and the construction of a new drainage system which will be centered on the site of the old Lazarus building and run underneath the National Bank of Middlebury parking lot and out to Otter Creek through Marble Works property. I mentioned those properties in particular because the first thing I want to note is that right-of-way planning for those two activities will begin at the end of this month, or actually not the planning, but the meetings that will take place in town with the property owners. And so VHB has delivered right-of-way plans and draft easement deeds to VTrans, and the VTrans right-of-way section is reviewing those now. And toward the end of the month, they will begin meeting with local property owners. As a representative of the LPMT, I'll be accompanying the ROW point person from VTrans at those meetings to facilitate discussions with our local property owners, but also to understand the flow of information between VTrans and the property owners, and then report that back to the LPMT. So this is the first phase of on the street discussions with our property owners. Again, this is just related to the activity that will take place in the fall. Later this summer, there will be a round two of right-of-way discussions that touch on the larger construction project that will take place next spring. Okay, so that's the right-of-way activity. Second, the LPMTs, one of its chief concerns has been throughout the process has been with water quality, and certainly that's a concern shared by the community and by you as well. And so what's happening there right now is that the VHB and VTrans are going to represent their plan for stormwater runoff, managing stormwater runoff, and for dealing with rail corridor water in the new drainage system. They'll represent that to DEC on May 23rd and get DEC's input on that plan, and with a focus on what constitutes best practice with this kind of drainage system and with this kind of stormwater runoff management. So again, I'll attend that meeting as a representative of the LPMT to understand what DEC's response is. Well, to understand first what the drainage system and stormwater runoff plan has evolved into, what DEC's response is, and then bring that back to the LPMT. That will lead to a what we're calling a water quality forum that will take place here either on June 8th or 9th in Middlebury. VTrans and VHB, DEC will come to Middlebury and present the plan as it currently exists, and then solicit feedback questions from the community. So
when did you say that was? I'm sorry, I didn't.
It'll be either June 8th or 9th.
Okay.
So we'll have the meeting with DEC on May 23rd. We'll have a couple of weeks to kind of take in what they've learned there and then present to the town. And I think that's a key step. There are a lot of questions still surrounding this new drainage system and how, particularly in the case of a hazmat spill, things would be handled. I think the LPMT wants to make sure that it fully understands if things go wrong, what will happen. And so we've asked VTrans and VHB to address that issue. And Don and Nick, did you want to add anything on that issue?
Nope, I think that's
right. Could I ask? I mean, this is an issue that Heather raised a month ago or something mm-hmm. like that, and yep. It has to do with the fact that, I mean, not only stormwater runoff, but also, I mean, suppose a railroad car carrying oil were to burst and so on. I think the concern would be that the drainage system would carry that into the river, almost facilitate it. So mm-hmm. I mean, is there some way to, in the event that there's an emergency, to prevent that from happening?
Mm-hmm. Sure.
Would they consider that in their overall design?
Yeah, I can report to you that the initial design of the drainage system had no ability to filter or cap, as I understood it. Mm-hmm. And that's why the push from the LPMT and from the community, frankly, to say that's not good enough and look for other options. And that's what's happening right now. Is there an opportunity to cap the outfall? You know, in the event of a hazmat spill, does that make the situation better? Does it make it worse? We don't know those answers. I think DEC will certainly weigh in on those answers, and the
LP, I mean, the answers would be forthcoming at some point.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Yeah. Okay. And because I think it is a matter of great concern.
I think VHB, which is designing the drainage system, and VTrans, which has to sign off on it, I think it's fair to say that they understand in great clarity what the town's concerns are. What the design changes will be that will take those into account. What's possible, mm-hmm. We don't know yet.
And will you say VHB design it and VTrans sign off on it? Will we also have an opportunity to sign off on it?
I would think so.
Hmm?
I would think so.
We certainly requested that, Victor. We requested.
Okay. Well, I would want to
that on that outfall that there be some kind of emergency situation that we would agree to
have an opportunity to express our approval or disapproval of the plan with regard to the safety of the town. Since it is happening here, and we have this, whatever one wants to call it, management relationship, that I would hope that, that somehow it would come back to this board, and that we would be able to.
Yeah, that's why we're having the forum. Now, the work right now is scheduled to begin in mid-November. We're having this forum on June 8th or 9th.
I realize the public, but that forum is going to give public information, and I guess the question I have is that insofar as our responsibility is the safety of the town, that I would want, and I think probably other members of the select board, an opportunity to say, well, maybe more has to be done. So that it wouldn't be simply a decision of V-Trans.
I think the LPMT has made that clear, and Rich Tatro, the assistant deputy, made the comment at an LPMT meeting a couple of weeks ago that we need to look for ways to go above and beyond.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, could I say, I mean, insofar as local project management team is our creation, that we would instruct you to see that's addressed properly. I at least would like.
Well, I think Jim mentioned that the point was well heard.
Yeah.
I had the impression the point was well heard by Rich Tatro and the VHP.
No, okay.
And so that they are, now that they've heard that, we've actually asked them to figure out what the solution is.
Okay.
And how that would be addressed so that we see something.
Okay, but I guess I've lived long enough to have people say to me, "I've heard you," and I'm sorry, but I mean, I think this is a rather important issue, and
I think it's a critical issue, and
yeah.
And you know, the process after that public forum to a decision is going to be one in which the town, the select board, is deeply involved. You know, I would think there's going to be some negotiation back and forth over this, depending on what the solution looks like and what it does.
Susan?
Just to be helpful, you may find stormwater management is different than an emergency spill response.
Yes,
the best management practices. What I imagine is that they'll be sort of outlining both of those best management practices. And they may have tweaked the design so that the emergency spill response works better with the stormwater,
mm-hmm.
that the stormwater works a little bit better with whatever the best management practices would be for the emergency spill response. But you don't really design stormwater around the emergency.
I realize they're two different things, but they're both.
But that's probably what they're going to do is take you through that entire journey and then show you how they cross over. And there may be a design change in there
mm-hmm.
to facilitate best management practices for both of them. But, from what you were saying, I can see them sort of taking you through that scenario.
Yeah.
But there's regulations, and as long as the regulations are meeting those best management practices, you may find that there's not a whole lot that you can do, but they might give the town that option. But as long as you're sort of meeting those regulations or exceeding them, then that's good enough, you know. So I think to think about what your requirements are and what you're looking for in that design going into it may be really helpful. To know, they'll say, well, what else do you want? We've met all the, you know, like, what else are you looking for? To be thinking about that, it's sort of hard to know until you see it.
Right.
But that's, you know, that's the trick.
Yeah. But finally, I think it's a matter of us being persuaded that this is the best.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Exactly.
And I think that should be specify that it would come here and we would.
You want to be able to say, no, this is not okay with me.
That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, if I could add one thing in the discussion that we had with them. What they said was, initially, is that it could cost millions and millions of dollars to try to install shut-off valves at the outfall. And that there was not the money in the project to begin with to be able to do something like that and add a pit that's dug down 35 feet deep, that it would be
right.
It's cost prohibitive. On the other hand, having the local project management team would say, well, that may be true, but we need an answer that will mitigate a circumstance if we have a hazardous spill. Mm-hmm. And so there'll be the normal outfall, and what we've asked is, I think what Jim was pointing out, is can we not find some way also, aside from emergency response procedures, which they'll follow, mm-hmm. can we not find some way to maybe cap that outfall if necessary, assuming it doesn't create a larger hazard in terms of holding all of that in the
right.
in the holding pit.
Right.
So they've been asked that question. I think they'll certainly respond to it at that open
okay.
hearing right. because they've been very specifically asked about it.
Mm-hmm. I mean, the trying to read between some of the lines and some of the things you're hearing from them is that what we're essentially going to be looking at is taking what is a normal drainage system and for a brief time during an emergency turn it into a holding tank
right.
that could then be where the product that was spilled could then be safely removed
mm-hmm.
rather than going into the river. And so
right.
I mean, you hear some of the discussion, maybe in its simplicity, is a valve system that just shuts off that drain and says that's it.
Right.
But that's something that they
that's
are looking at it, and so we'll see where they what they okay. come back to us with.
And that's what I talked to Donna about, that mm-hmm. you may find that in that explanation that they say that actually creates a pinch point.
Could very well.
And that if that person, who's designated, do they know, are they around? Did someone accidentally close it down and then someone else came and opened it back up but didn't tell the other person? In that situation, you're creating, everything's hinging on that, you know? And so you may find that they have better ways to handle that. So, you know, to say that sounds like a good thing, but in an emergency, I've been in that situation and everyone's looking at each other, you know, do you need to contact one person to get that valve? It might not be the best, and it might be far more expensive, and 10 years out, people forget that it's even there, you know, and that happens all the time. So just, you know, think about what works and what you're looking for, and you may not get the answer, but it may be better than what you were even thinking
of. I think the fact that the micro tunnel that connects the outlaunch to the outfall is 25 feet underground is a big part of the problem in the design, but that seems to be a given. So what they're looking into is how to deal with an extraordinary situation,
right?
Basically, so I think the LPMT's response now is let's let the professionals reevaluate
mm-hmm.
where we are. They brought in DEC, so you've got the environmental folks here. Let's see what the solution looks like,
yeah.
And there'll be an opportunity for the public to weigh in on that. Following which, the LPMT and the select board can evaluate where we are. I think so. And when we have a final date for that, I'll let everyone know, but either June or 8th or 9th. Just quickly, a couple of other things. If we can move on from water quality, a temporary parking deck has been part of the plan throughout, and this would be a state-funded deck. That would add somewhere in the neighborhood of 40 spaces to offset what would be lost in the center of town here during construction. Right now, the LPMT is leaning toward the possibility of a temporary parking deck being located in the Mill Street parking lot to encourage, over the long term, better use of that parking facility. And so we've asked that VHB, who is doing the design work, and the firm that would supply the hardware come for a site visit to Middlebury. So there'll be more on that as we move forward here.
Well, and part of that too, what led part of that discussion moving that direction was the distinct possibility that the parking structure won't actually fit in the space behind Ilsley.
Yeah.
That looks problematic just from a geometric point of view.
Mm-hmm. So more to come on that. Briefly, the relocation of the Merchant Actor Merchants Row bus stop. The LPMT has invested quite a bit of time in evaluating where that would best fit right now. What's being looked at is the north end of South Pleasant Street. I think I've discussed, I mentioned this before to the select board. In this scenario, South Pleasant Street would be would become one-way southbound, and the buses would enter the northbound lane, protected by Jersey barriers and other things that would allow for safe entrance into that area and exiting that area. A lot of details in that plan, so I won't go into that tonight. We're still firming that up and looking at how that would work before we would hold a public meeting of the South Pleasant Street neighborhood. But when we get the plans finalized and the LPMT feels that we have a solid plan for moving forward, I'd like to share that with the select board with a visual so you can see how that would work. Dan Werner's been very involved in helping us evaluate that space there. And then finally, the second letter that we received from Peter Langrock on May 3rd in response to our response to his letter. I think there are two primary issues that the LPMT sees there, or two questions that were raised by the letter. One is who is accountable and liable, and you know, who's in charge, who's accountable and liable. That's the first question. The second question is, where's the rest of the documentation that we've asked for? I think I'm paraphrasing a bit, you know, a lengthy letter and set of responses, but basically I think that's what it comes down to. So the LPMT is addressing that first question, you know, what's the who's in charge, who's accountable, who's liable, by working with VTrans to revise the grant agreement that was signed in 2013. And that lays out the responsibilities of the town versus that of VTrans. And that now is a dated document that was signed at a time when the town was going to fully manage the project. That is now no longer the case. And so VTrans is revising the grant agreement to to clarify the responsibilities of the town, and specifically of the LPMT, my position, as we move into construction. And so a lot of details that we can share with you is that we see a draft of the grant agreement, but essentially VTrans would take over management of the project at the point at which construction begins. And all invoices would flow directly into to VTrans rather than through the town as they do now. And the town's, the LPMT has made clear that they want it to be clearly articulated what its ongoing responsibilities would be and involvement, to make sure that the select board through the LPMT continues to have a strong voice in how the project is managed. And so I think the revision of that grant agreement, and we'll see a draft on May 20th, is kind of key to answering what's a pretty fundamental question that's raised in the second Langrock letter, you know, about who's doing what, who's responsible for what. The documentation question is more easily dealt with. A lot of that documentation exists online already, and so I will assemble that and put it together into a draft response to Peter Langrock and his clients that, you know, has that additional documentation in it. If the documentation is not yet available, here's when it will become available, the response can also note the revision of the grant agreement too. So it's an ongoing dialogue, you know, that's been, I think that the LPMT has seen the benefits of the letter from Peter and has worked with our partners, VTrans and VHB, accordingly to make this a positive, cooperative exchange.
Am I correct, then, there'll be a draft, you have a date for a draft grant agreement?
Correct. VTrans has committed to providing a draft to the LPMT on May 20th.
On May 20th.
Mm-hmm.
And that, is there any, I mean, it seems to me, I think the letter that Peter's written, I like it better than the first one. It seems to me that's a really crucial issue, that we now are dealing with an obsolete grant agreement, and so This would then what, come before the select board?
Yes. It'd be legal counsel first, Kathleen.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Legal counsel review it, and then it'll come before us.
And sure. And are you thinking sometime maybe in June that we would have an updated?
It sounds reasonable. I think if it comes to the LPMT on May 20th and the LPMT reviews it and legal counsel reviews it at the same time for that first kind of round of review, I would think that the revision process could go fairly quickly to get a second round back to us in time to share, you know, in early June. You know, with construction just around the corner and these kind of liability issues hanging over us, I think it's a good idea to move as quickly as possible, assuming that what the LPMT is asking for in this is what's delivered. So
I think, you know, to that point, we have the opportunity to amend.
Yes.
When the grant comes in, the LPMT will certainly look at that, and if there are things that are missing in there, we'll certainly amend them, and then we would have legal counsel look at them as well.
Right.
And, you know, the group would present it here to the select board, and there could be further discussion of, you know, is there anything in there that we really hope to have there? You know, so that you're really looking at it and scrutinizing it. But I think you're going to figure that's going to have to take at least a couple of weeks.
Mm-hmm. Oh, but I'm glad. I mean, it seems that they're addressing it now with all delivery speed, which I'm.
They are. I think got pushed into gear,
very pleased to hear.
There will be I should note there'll be a second agreement too, called a finance and maintenance agreement, that will address the transfer of the town approved $500,000 to V-Trans at some point. That's the commitment that the town made to the to the tunnel landscaping here. But it'll also address ongoing maintenance responsibilities for things like stormwater, which in the current grant agreement say it'll be I think divided equally, or you know, V-Trans and the town shall be equally responsible for maintenance of stormwater. So I think things like that have to be spelled out. What exactly does that mean? And now's the point that we're further along to take a little harder look at that.
Good. Are there any other questions?
Well, just related to communication, because you have a website, and how is that going in terms of using that as a vehicle to communicate what you just presented tonight?
I've been running around a lot over the last two or three weeks, things settle a little bit, what I'd like to do is use that website to post, for example, what we talked about tonight, and to use that as a vehicle for communicating out. Right now, the website's up; it's live. It has information on there. What it doesn't yet have is the kind of daily feed or the regular feed that would keep folks out, you know, in the community aware of the discussion we had tonight, for example.
Right. So if you go to the town's website, you can get all the documents. If you click on the button that says Downtown Rail, but that's not your website. You know, that just brings you to all the documents. So is that going to get transferred to the website? So
yeah.
Then
right now, there's, if you click on, you know, with the weekly letter that goes out with the update, if you click on the rail link there, it goes to my website. It just hasn't been.
I
have to work with Tom Scanlon to get that link over to my website too, the other one that's on the front page of the town's website. So just the technology.
So how do we get to your website? You have to type in MiddleburyBridges.org.
Or with the weekly email that comes out from Kathleen saying here are the upcoming events, or anything that comes out from the town in an email, on that right-hand column where it says Middlebury Bridges Project.
Oh, that's where it is.
You click there and it goes right to it.
Okay.
So, but I just have to get the piece fixed where on the town's main website page, it still kicks over to the document page because there's still a lot of documents on there. So.
Right. So eventually those documents would go into that website.
Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah. It could certainly be duplicated over there.
Yeah, they could sit in both places, but basically become an art, you know, they mm-hmm. both places would archive the documents.
So are you considering expanding the frequently asked questions to respond to some of these things? Because I know that I've been asked about water quality. It'd be good to direct people to a response there.
Yep.
That would be easier.
It's built. It needs to kind of get all the things that are happening day in and day out onto that website, and shared with the community.
I'd like to make the comment that, at this point, and we're very fortunate in this, is that, you know, the LPMT is a group of now five people, previously four people, just trying to find a meeting date for all of us that are available at the same time, since everybody has jobs, is difficult. When they have meetings in either South Burlington or Montpelier, you know, for the VHB or Kubricki or whoever it is, VTrans, we can't get all of us at those meetings, and Jim attends all of those meetings on our behalf. Mm-hmm. He takes notes from all of those meetings, which he forwards into the LPMT group, and we truly appreciate that. So the amount of time he's spending on the project at this point is in gathering information. It'll be great when he has the time to post it. Some of it has been so in flux that I think that's why it's not up there yet.
Yeah.
For example, the water quality issue has not been, we'll know a lot more after the June 8th or June 9th meeting. At this point, there's nothing to say to someone except that we have concerns about it and that it's being looked at. So I just wanted to let you know that Jim is so busy. I think that, you know, ideally, you know, that website will be fully functional, certainly when construction starts and we can stop sending him to meetings on our behalf. That will be very beneficial.
Yeah.
Thank you, Jim.
Thank you, Heather.
Thank you for all your hard work on this.
Mm-hmm. Thanks. Yeah, I appreciate it. Yeah. Well, it's I've really enjoyed getting to see the world from VTrans's and VHB's point of view. I think it's been beneficial. And just the information flow, there's a lot of streams of activity on this project. From I've just given you a small sampling here, and so that it's been a real pleasure to be able to facilitate the flow of information into the town, to the LPMT, and to you as well. So well, thank you. I appreciate that.
Thanks, Jim.
Can I just ask one quick question?
Sure.
On the website, do we have any monitoring in place? So, like, right now, how many hits a day we're getting so that, like, we can compare that to the construction season, how, you know, like, next year when they start?
Yeah.
How many, do you have any kind of monitoring in
there's
place?
There's analytics. I haven't quite tapped into that.
Okay.
It's a Wix developed platform, and there are analytics associated with that.
Okay.
And so, you know, once I kind of get it more fully functional and running, I can, you know, begin to compare, you know, what it was in May of this year versus what it's like in May of next year.
I mean, by next year, it might be more interesting than it is right now, but I was just curious if there was anything in place or not.
So. Yeah, there's this kind of these behind-the-scenes analytics that tell you who's hitting what page and that kind of thing. So.
Okay.
Well, by this time next year, it definitely will be more interesting.
Yes.
Yeah. So, okay. Sorry to take up a lot of extra time, but appreciate the questions.
We built a little time in.
Okay,
but we just went 2 minutes over, so.
Uh-oh. It's trouble.
Kathleen, would you walk us through the...
Well, actually, we are very fortunate tonight to have a member of the Solar Task Force here, Amy Sheldon. So maybe Amy wants to walk us through the Solar Task Force.
First rule, no surprise.
Yeah, now that you,
all prepared with the TV interview, that's
welcome back home during the week.
Thank you. Actually, I saw this on the agenda. The weird thing about being in Montpelier is you're representing the best town in Vermont, but you have no connection back to it. So you have to come and catch up on everything that's happening. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I saw this and I thought I should see what's happening. Mm-hmm. But maybe, how did it get here on the agenda?
So, what happened after the Planning Commission referred it to the Select Board, the Select Board referred it to the Energy Committee. The Energy Committee made some slight adjustments in the wording. And so the process would be for it to come back before the Select Board for discussion, then refer it back to the Planning Commission for incorporation in the town's plan and zoning regulations.
So I probably don't have the latest draft. I have the draft we had from November 16th when we presented it to the Planning Commission.
Right, on the screen we have those.
Would you like?
Okay, in red.
That
right.
Was added by
the Energy Committee.
And Laura was there for that so she could fill us in as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they're minor, but good points that just refine the standard. So, yeah, you can see on there. I don't know if we want to read them or just...
Maybe, Amy, you could give us the big picture of why the Solar Task Force came together.
Well, sure. I guess, I mean, we came together out of an interest in countywide and statewide in the challenges around renewable energy siting. And then we wanted to look at, and we, excuse me, it was Steve Terry, RJ Adler, and myself, and we met half a dozen times over the summer. We wanted to kind of get the lay of the land in Middlebury and figure out what would be best for our community when addressing sites for renewable energy. So we looked at what the existing town plan had in it for addressing solar, mostly solar, and then we also looked at, we had, actually Legislative Council helped us out by telling us what the existing state statutes were. I say were, because we might have changed them if the governor, I don't know if he decided to sign S-230 or not. We'll see. I think he will sign it the way it came out late Friday night. But anyway, so we looked at existing state statutes, and then we also had, from a winter term class that I taught a number of years ago now, we had the beginning of some, what would solar siting look like in Middlebury that the students had drafted as part of conservation planning class for winter term, that these students actually really did get into it, and I was able to review it in more depth during the summer when we looked at it. And then as a final step, we went out in the field to see where solar had been sited in Middlebury and whether or not the map that the students had come up with had any kind of value to us as we were considering what direction to send, you know, the town policies in. And then we came up with these consensus principles. We did find it was interesting to see how the existing sites in Middlebury were, they were in places that fell on the map. The map is pretty generous. There's a lot of potential for solar in Middlebury. And then also think about, the students looked at view sheds, scenic view sheds, as one way of filtering, you know, are there acceptable sites that would not obstruct important views, sort of the iconic views of Middlebury? And the Land Trust had actually started years before with a public outreach process. So we had these somewhat non-scientific view sheds already identified by the public, and then the students did some computer analysis with view sheds, which was pretty high-end, high-tech. And then we came up with these 8 consensus principles. You know, the town, Middlebury Town Plan, as it exists today, does support renewable energy. I think the town plan, I know that at least the group that I was part of, our hope is that Middlebury would be, you know, kind of a net zero community, that we would find a way to be a sustainable energy producer that met our own local needs, obviously as part of being tied into the grid, not that we would be separate from that. So we supported, you want me to summarize the 8 principles? The no surprise rule, essentially the way we try to do development in Middlebury anyway, whatever the development is have the community be aware, work with the developers up front. Same with the Planning Commission, have the Planning Commission work on optimum sites, look at adopting screening guidelines set forth in Act 56. I'm curious what did you change that one? As a foundation for developing standards, is that the one? Number 3. At the time, the Public Service Board had the due consideration kind of clause for working, which we found to be most likely to be adequate if you had a good solid town plan. There, as you, I'm sure, have all followed the solar siting controversies throughout the state, the Public Service Board has been, I think, kind of working on it, how to work with town plans. But the new legislation will actually give substantial deference to town plans that have gone through an approval process through regional planning commissions and provide for an appeal process through the Natural Resource Board. So that is part of why you're getting this now, is that the thought was, I think, to bring it to you after the legislature had tried to come up with what the next iteration would be and how to address this. Our group supported that the existing structure, that the Public Service Board was the appropriate way for renewable energy to be administered, overseen in the state. There were folks interested in looking to Act 250 and different ways of reviewing it. So when we wrote this, we wanted to be clear that we supported the existing. Again, number six is be proactive in identifying places that we would like to have renewable energy cited, and encourage the town permitting system to require public and commercial buildings that could support solar. I'm sure, as you know, because you went through building this building most recently, some commercial buildings are solar ready and some are not. And so I think having that conversation, and number eight extends that to looking at what other buildings in town that are already built could support solar.
Excuse me, Amy.
Yeah.
There's an inconsistency.
Oh, sorry.
We don't have a six.
No, we don't seem to have that.
We don't have a six.
We jump from five to seven, and we don't have an eight.
Good. Thanks for saying that. Maybe because six was redundant a little bit, I think, with.
And we didn't catch the number change to me from.
I'm going back to see if it was any longer.
But to your point.
But do you have the content that I've been talking about? Okay.
Yeah. We do have the content that you're talking about.
Other than
about.
We don't have an eight, so. Uh-huh.
Okay, well, eight's just come. Oh, the one with working, inventorying potential sites on existing buildings and working with the college on how we could support each other in their, they have a carbon neutral pledge by 2016. So how could the solar siting, you know, how could we build energy there, so to speak? Synergy.
Mm-hmm. The one that we posted back in January.
Okay, I don't know what happened there.
What was six again?
I had six is encourage the Planning Commission and the Town Energy Committee to develop locations, suggested locations that are very suitable for ground-mounted solar development, as well as those sites that are not. Did you have that one in your list?
It's not in our list, but I know that we talked about it. Yeah. You know, that's been the intention.
Yeah. I thought that was sort of the prime.
So we're just missing six and eight.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, I don't know if we're missing it as much as a decision was made, I guess, somewhere not to include six and eight, perhaps.
It could have been a typo. I wouldn't have seen that.
I think we need to find that out before we adopt this.
Yeah, so the draft I'm looking at was presented to the Planning Commission at a November 16th meeting.
So complete solar
right.
is what we're looking for.
So we'll have it for the next meeting, right? But that's good that you went through it, because you just helped us find. I was going to ask where six was, but now I didn't know there was an eight.
Okay. Oh, because yours actually skipped six.
Yeah. It went from five to seven.
Five, seven, and then
no
seven,
eight.
That actually maybe does lead you to think that it was a typo. If someone wanted it out on purpose, you think
I remember this coming before the Energy Committee, and I don't remember six and eight. I just remember what we see here, and I don't remember catching that there was there were missing items like that. We went from five to seven.
Yeah.
So what's nine, Amy?
Uh-huh. Worth it to go back in.
Nine is integrate the new legislation that was just passed.
Well, she's here. Are there any questions? We've for those of you who are new to the Select Board, we discussed this and actually sent that back to them, because the original one was asking that all buildings be solar ready, not recommended, and that was one of our concerns. For instance, it's making sure that we, while we're encouraging this, that we still maintain a competitive posture in attracting businesses and growth. So it's nice to see that it came back with very few changes, but with some recommended changes. And I think we just need to make sure we have the final one before we approve it. Moving forward. But if there's any questions while Amy's here.
Well, to your point, Brian, you know, with number seven, as it reads right now, I call it number seven, encourage the town permitting system to recommend that all public and commercial buildings be solar ready. Is that language that's acceptable to you? Or you're saying that's still not what you were looking
encourage
for?
Encourage versus require.
Right.
There's, it's,
Well, it says encouraged.
The last one said required.
The other one said required.
It said require new construction.
New construction.
Well, this one doesn't.
Right.
Yeah, no.
So he likes that better.
It's amended, that's why I'm commenting that, while we continue to encourage it, we're not requiring it. No. At least that's the way I read it.
Although some states are. Did you know that?
But until our neighboring towns are.
But I think, to your bigger point, does anyone have other questions or concerns so that when you go back to the Planning Commission?
Yeah, I think it.
Okay.
Because I think really, I mean, the idea is that if you guys endorse it, then we move ahead with it.
So is there anything in S-230 that would be good for the board to know relative to this?
I think what I already said, the biggest difference would be for a town like Middlebury will be the change from due consideration to substantial deference, which is how they review the town plan. The important piece in there is that you have a strong, clear, specific town plan so that, you know, and we're not a town that's headed towards saying no to renewable energy siting. I think that the biggest concern or conversations were around the fear that some towns might say, well, we don't want any. Or, you know, I think you'll write a town plan that meets the goals for the regional plan, and then the regional plan will also support the state's goal of 90% renewables by 2030. So that is now codified in S-230 as the process that will happen. And then there's also an appeal process that's been outlined that goes not through the Public Service Board, but through the Natural Resources Board, which is the Act 250, the group that oversees Act 250. So those are the kind of the big pivot points in the state conversation that people were struggling with. Mm-hmm. And the final one had to do with large-scale wind and how sound was regulated. We're not at this point looking at any large-scale wind in our area, so it doesn't really specifically relate to us. I'm happy to answer questions about it or anything else that you all are wondering about that I could help with for the end of session wrap-up.
You did get out of there, though.
We got out of there. Yeah. I was happy to get out. Almost Friday night, but Saturday morning. That's good.
Thank you for your service.
Thank you.
You're welcome. There's some very lovely tributes to Representative Nuovo also.
I've read them. They brought tears to my eyes, I must say. Yeah,
to all of us. So it's good. She's done great service and will be missed. Thank you.
Thank you, Amy.
Thanks, Amy.
Nick.
Okay, well, a couple things. One is the flagpole, which is slated to be placed on the outside here. We have really nothing new on that at this point as far as cost, other than it appears it's going to cost less than was originally envisioned. So that is something I'd like to hold on to a later point. And then with respect to demolition of buildings, I've only been recently looking at this, and I think from the perspective of efficiency of presentation, I've asked Kathleen to give a summary because she's been right at the core of this. So Kathleen, if you would not mind.
So for tonight, we're going to be looking at the asbestos and lead abatement portion of the contract. I would ask that you defer on the demolition contract. There's a little bit more research we have to do based on some materials testing. The materials testing that was done earlier this week after the bids were received came back favorably. But we just need to check with the contractor that everything is in order. So, on to the lead and asbestos hazardous material abatement. You have in your packet a recommendation from Kyle Austin from Clay Point Associates that reports that 3 out of 5 firms contacted responded to the town's request for proposal for lead and asbestos abatement at the municipal building and gymnasium at 94 Main Street. Given the size and scope of the project and the relatively tight time frame for completion, Clay Point recommends awarding the abatement contract for the municipal building to Environmental Hazard Management, Inc., and the contract for the gymnasium abatement to Catamount Environmental. They have been in contact with both of the firms, and both firms are agreeable to this approach. So, all told, you have Clay Point Associates putting in their costs for project oversight and inspection. For the three line items detailed in the agenda notes, totaling $15,715. CAD amount for $114,500. What is not included in their price is the performance bond, which is 3.5% of the contract price, and that amounts to $4,007.50 for CAD amount. EHM for their bid for $77,779, and their performance bond for $2,722.27, bringing the total estimated project cost to $214,723.77. So if the board is agreeable to accepting Kyle Austin's recommendation about awarding the base bid for the municipal building to EHM and the base bid for the gymnasium to Catamount for the prices, then motion would be in order.
So moved.
Was waiting.
I don't receive your questions. Like, I'm second.
No.
No, definitely second.
I was looking for you because it was your committee. I didn't know if you would.
I wanted to make that motion for questions for anybody. But no, definitely. And I actually appreciate the work on this because, and thank you, Kathleen, because this is a tight deadline to get this work done. So this makes a very logical approach to take care of this.
And with the lead and asbestos work taking more time than anticipated, that will give us some more time to take a look at the demolition bids and answer all the questions we have.
Okay. Any questions?
So people are still asking about the timeline for the demolition. So is it
demolition
still
late June?
Late June.
We're still on track for that.
Okay. Okay.
With the abatement, we had initially planned for the abatement to be done by June 14th, probably another week. Yeah.
Thank you.
Any other questions?
So we're not discussing the demolition tonight?
I'm happy to take any questions you may have on that.
I just wondered about the bonding, but we got both.
Both are bonded.
Okay.
Or bondable.
So all in favor of the motion to approve the environmental portion of the contract, signify by saying aye.
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 And those opposed? Okay. Unanimous? I did have one question, Kathleen, just for the clarification of the board. At this point, does it look like it's coming in somewhere within the college's budget for this?
They have passed these numbers by the college, and they are comfortable.
They're comfortable. Okay.
I think it's within the range that they anticipated it would be.
So, Kathleen, the year-to-date budget report.
As of this afternoon, I give you some input from all of the department heads, as I promised I would at your last meeting. I'll go over those quickly. So year to date, as of April 30th, 2016, 83% through the fiscal year, the general fund is in very good shape. And we're anticipating ending the year with a in surplus situation, thanks mostly to our mild winter, low fuel and heating costs, and a couple of vacancies that we have. So going through my memo to you, the Planning and Zoning Department has had a vacancy in the assistant zoning administrator position, and we also had a partial year vacancy in the planning the director position, so we're anticipating about a $50,000 savings there. town clerk, and Webster reports that she is on track for her department. I'm noting that our legal budget is going to be under budget. We have a budget of $36,000, and only $14,000 of that spent here to date. So anticipating a budget surplus there of $16,000. Library Director Kevin Unrath reports that he is on track, as his fire department chief David Shaw reporting. On a $1.4 million budget, Chief Hanley is reporting that he's going to squeak in slightly under budget by about $2,000. We like precision. Public Works Operations Director Dan Miller reports that he's anticipating about a $72,000 under budget in the Highway Department, mostly to the mile winter. Parks and Recreation Director Terry Arnold reported in detail on her budget, and I summarized that if we extrapolate based on last year's results, she's going to be $50,000 over budget, partially offset by revenues over budget of $30,000, but still in a deficit position there. But with all of the other surpluses we have, we still anticipate will be about $100,000 under budget, which on a $10 billion budget is agreeable. That's it.
It's very good management of the town's finances, Kathleen.
I have a great team. Mm-hmm. We have a great team.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And Susan had also noted at one of your prior meetings on the water fund budget, that we'll get into in detail, that the meter reading revenue seemed out of whack. And that is partially thanks to the improvement in the economy. That revenue comes from a sale or a refinancing of a property. The town sends someone out to read the meter. It's a $20 charge. So that adds up over time. It's not a lot of money, but
hey, we'll take it.
I'm sorry, I missed
the
that.
Meter reading revenue in the water department budget. It's about $1,000.
It was like 1,260% up from what it was budgeted.
Last year we had budgeted $100 in FY15, and we ended up with $1,200. It was way over percentage-wise. This year we had budgeted better for that, but still coming in a little bit over budget for that.
I was just curious.
It's great that the economy is improving.
What is going on over
here? Revised with housing and the housing market's rebounding. That's great.
Yeah.
Okay.
Just curious.
Would you care to give us the check warrants?
I have reviewed the check warrants. They're in good order. We have total expenditures of $249,575.14. Our accounts payable was $162,472.96. Our payroll was $87,102.18. So I move that we approve the check warrants.
I'll second.
Thank you, Susan.
We're losing everybody.
Yes. All in favor of the check warrants, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Okay.
Ooh.
Kathleen.
Okay. One thing to report, update on conference room acoustics. on Tuesday morning, this morning, Brad workers were in the building to start to take apart the ceiling in the conference room so that a mechanical technician can evaluate available space to increase the amount of ductwork, the purpose of which is to decrease noise generated by mechanical systems, which have been causing difficulty with hearing during meetings. The situation will not be corrected by this evening's meeting in time for your meeting, but you can inform attendees that it will be tentatively corrected by Friday the 13th.
By Friday the 13th.
Good one.
What did they give you any feedback? Is it they're just going to add more ducting up there, and that's going to solve it? Interesting.
They're going to try.
Will there be more outlets? Is that the situation?
I don't know. I'll get a full report the next.
That's
meeting.
All right. We'll see it.
Out.
We'll see it. Okay, great.
Fill the room with duct.
Anything else, Kathleen? Okay, board member concerns. Donna?
No, I do not have any this evening.
Wow. Sure.
That fire department fundraiser ham dinner was mighty fine. It was great to see our fire department staffing that. So just wanted to report that. That's about it.
Good. Susan, I can't believe you endured all that pain. I
yeah,
only saw you stand up once.
I'm going home and icing. I hurt my back.
Yes,
so that's why I got stood up. I wasn't trying to be offensive to anyone.
We weren't taking it.
I'm like, oh my gosh. I wanted, there'll be invitations that go out to everyone, but mark your calendars for June 12th. It's a Sunday from 12 to about 2:30, the East Middlebury Community Picnic. All the select members are invited, as well as some of the staff. Everyone's invited. They usually provide hamburgers, hot dogs, and beverages and desserts, and ask people bring a side dish to share. But it's always exciting to have board members come and participate. So keep an eye out for it and join us in East Middlebury.
When is it?
On Sunday, June 12th.
Okay.
It used to be in July, but it got pretty darn hot, and we decided to move it to when it wasn't so hot.
It's before people are traveling as much, too.
Exactly.
School's still in session.
Try and catch people, and it's a fun time. So that's up.
Could I mention one other event? I'm sorry.
I'm sorry. You already used your
I know.
Time.
I'm sorry. Well, this Saturday.
What is it, Laura?
Sorry. Well, this Saturday is the Sustainability Expo that the Middlebury Energy Committee is presenting, and it really will be a great opportunity to check in on transportation options, integrative health, growing food, raising chickens if you want, you know, like that sort of thing, and lots more, and there'll be children's activities. So it's only $5. Children are free, and I recommend that you come and check that out. A lot of work went into planning it, and it's a little later than usual this year to try to take advantage of the better weather, I guess, and so we'll see if that works. And it's from 9 to 4 at the Middlebury Union Middle School. The middle school this time.
It was at the high school last time.
It has been, but this is the high school wasn't available for when they wanted to offer it.
Okay. Heather?
I don't have anything this evening.
Victor? Mm-hmm. I bet you can hear a lot better right now.
Blower's gone.
We'll see.
Well, the blower just shut off.
The blower
is off. I was wondering what happened. I thought I heard thunder. Yeah. Well, anyway.
Nick?
Nothing tonight.
What'd you say?
We've been here since 5:30. Okay, everybody's punch drunk. We don't have any need for an executive session, correct? So with that, I just thank everybody. It was informative. The open meeting is always nice. I've had one of those before, but it's nice to have a refresher training. And actually, it's nice to hear some of the changes that are forthcoming. Mm-hmm. I think that'll make many people's lives just a little bit easier. And one of the things I did pick up is we hadn't been voting according to the proper procedure when we had Collins.
Yeah.
So
I'm excited.
It'll make it a lot easier for that.
Mm-hmm. It makes it nicer for the person who's away because you know how everybody's voting.
Yes.
So
You won't have a need for that, though, in the future, unless
right.
it's not.
Unless it's contested. Right.
So, all right. With that, the meeting will adjourn at 9:38.
8:38. We're a record.
8:38, yeah.
This is the earliest we've been out in a long time.
Yes. Yeah.